You are listening to the Hiking Radio Network, where we talk the walk with shows by hikers about hikers for everybody.
Welcome to the Trail Dames podcast, where we speak with women who love to dance upon this earth. Hey everyone, welcome back to the Trail Dames podcast. If you've been listening for a while, I hope you've been enjoying my Appalachian Trail journal entries. I've been sharing with you tales of my own attempt at a through hike. Well, you might remember I mentioned several times my awesome friend, Jan Leitschuh. Leitschuh was a horse whisperer who one day got bitten by the AT bug, and she hiked the same year I did. And while she was doing her hike, she kept an extraordinary journal. She never published that journal, but she gave me permission to share it with you here on the Trail Dames podcast. The stories will come back in the future. But now for the next few months, I want you to take a trip on the AT with Leitschuh. She experiences every second of her hike with depth and with wonder, and she shares it beautifully. I know you're going to love it. My name is Anna. All my friends call me Mudbutt. And today I'm introducing you to my friend Leitschuh. Thanks for listening to the Trail Dames podcast. I'm gonna dance upon this earth. April 7th. Was I ever glad to be in a shelter last night? The heavens cracked open, the lightning slashed the windy skies, and buckets of water dumped down. Poor Chief! By the time I leave the shelter, the rain stops. Everything drips and smells of pine and last year's leaves. The birds seem particularly happy for the let-up, and they flute their optimism with a lusty gusto. My Chopat knee braces get a lot of comments at the shelters. They have worked like a charm, as they did on the long trail last year. Not a smidgen of pain knee out here. Prior to their discovery, I was generally limping by day three of a hike. So, to me, they are like miracle gear. I want someone to tell me of a similarly simple helper for my sore heels. By the way, the quote-unquote light miles, lightweight therapy is helping my tendons. My left heel is about 80% better, and the right heel is at least 50% improved. I no longer limp unless I've been sitting a while. I find human nature endlessly fascinating. For example, there seem to be a number of folks, both in life and on the trail, troubled by the fact that they don't know all there is to know in the world. These types appear to be psychologically unable to ask simple questions. It's as if by asking, they are giving something vital away. So their curiosity and their inquiry about equipment like my knee braces often takes the form of attack and criticism. Huh, pretty funny looking knee braces there. I find them very helpful. They look sweaty and hot. They do keep the joints warm on these cold mornings. I find that an asset. Well, you're cooking them in the summer. Well, by summer, I hope not to need them, at least until the White Mountains of New Hampshire. I'll bet they're expensive. No more expensive than being forced to take a rest day in town, and a lot less painful. An ace bandage would probably do the same thing for a lot less. Then you ought to buy yourself an ace bandage and see. They don't cost much. Nah, I don't have any knee pain. Whatever. Shoot, aches and pains are a big topic on the AT. Without them and food, what else would we talk about? The scenery today is lovely, though. Woods to Tennessee, rural hillside pasture to waterfalls and streams. I truly like the mix of rural hills and mountains with the occasional town thrown in for pizza. When my brother commented that he thought I was going to disappear into the wilderness for 6 months, I had to put him straight. No, it's 3 to 5 days of Appalachian backcountry, followed by a dip into small-town America. Sometimes there are even Krispy Kremes. This trek has scope. Actually, this is America, east of the Mississippi, America to be exact. You can't go for longer than 5 days or so without there being a road, even in the mountains. America loves her roads. And with roads nearby, can fast food be very far away? I learned a nifty trick yesterday from Hambone and Papa Bear, some section hikers. I came up to camp with a full water bag. I was looking for a nail to hang the handles on, but all of the nails were full of wet gear. So they showed me how to slip the handles into a crack between the planks of the picnic table. Then they inserted a little stick to keep the handles from slipping back through. Now the bag hung from the table. Handy, huh? Elegantly simple. I do love trail technology. One of my other favorites is to use a rhododendron leaf as a pipe or a sluice when the water source is too low for dipping. As long as it's flowing, I can fill my water bottle this way. I hiked most of the day with Scamp and Greylock, leapfrogging along, taking pictures of each other, crossing the stiles over pasture fences. When they found out that I was going to Irwin at Sam's Gap, they decided to join me. Yeah, when the scent of a burrito gets in your nostrils, it is hard to leave it be. Woo, woo, like an old hound dog. Though we didn't get rained on, the humidity was near 100%, and my shirt was soaking wet from the climbs. On one climb, the aptly named Frozen Knob, the wind blew extra cold, and the temperature dropped palpably. The sky split ice chunks at us, but as soon as we dropped down off the knob, the chill and the ice ceased. Pretty weird, huh? Can an old mountain knob be haunted? Scamp and Greylock joined me for the wait at Sam's Gap. Miss Janet has promised to pick me up at 6 p.m. Don't forget me, I pleaded when I made the arrangements 2 days earlier. I have these abandonment issues. Ah, she promised not to. I sent an email as a follow-up. We got to Sam's Gap early, about 4 p.m. It's now 6:45, and Scamp and Greylock are doubting that this ride thing exists. We are chilled and hungry, and now it is starting to rain. We've already turned down several rides, so as not to make Miss J make the trip for nothing. Left by the side of the road again, I am starting to get a complex. How long do we wait past 6 before we start hitching? Asks Scamp. Now. We jump up and we get a ride from Rick, whose sons have done the trail. If I had trusted hitchhiking to be this easy, I never would have arranged a shuttle. But then again, I thought I would be hitchhiking alone. We roll into Irwin and immediately hit up the famous Irwin Burrito. The chicken quesadilla gets 2 opposable thumbs up, maybe 3. Back at Miss Janet's hostel, many reunions. Swift Sandal, who I haven't seen since NOC, is there recovering from shin splints incurred in the snow. The snow took out a few hikers, it seems. Pop Pop was there, too. He had ridden up with Miss Janet to come and fetch me from Sam's Gap, then made her wait for me to come out of the woods in case I was hobbling. He had watched me limp painfully into Hot Springs, bless his heart. Hikers really do try to look out for each other. Turns out Janet hadn't forgotten about me, she explained. She had just been running late. She tries to do everything for everybody, so it's hard to stay mad at Miss Janet. We all sat in the kitchen yakking and laughing and drinking some sort of Coke and vodka concoction till way too late, and I slept on the couch as the hostel was full. Jan Leitschuh, AT Class of 03. April 8th. Though I spent the night in Irwin, languished in a hot shower like a city person, and ate hot, cheese-laden food. Today is still a work day. Out to hike, woman, it is what you do. Scamp and Greylock decide to walk on the wild side and try the slack-packing life. They will join me for the 13.5 miles from Sam's to Spivey Gap. They carry little day packs that Miss Janet loaned out for, quote-unquote, freedom hiking, as she calls it. I just like the feel of my own pack at my back. It's warmer and it blocks the wind for one. Plus, I can carry all my little comfort stuff. I really like the handy hip belt pockets on my ULA P2 pack. I just don't like the heavy weight. So I just take out my tent, sleeping bag, and food bag, and are replaced with the snacks that I need for the day. I do keep my clothing bag just in case we need to wait at Spivey Gap. I don't want to sit chilled in wet clothes. Another gray, damp day. We rejoined the AT at Sam's Gap, and we walked up the hills with a little jauntier step. I'm telling you, a lighter pack makes hiking a joy. All right, true confession. I love hiking and camping. It's backpacking I'm a little ambivalent about. It is a satisfying situation to have everything you need to survive for several days on your back. It enables one to go to soul-grabbing places that day hikers just can't. But oh, the price one pays on the feet, tendons, shins, and knees, hips, heart, and lungs. All day long, freedom hiking, my body thanks me for this little break. We crest the first big climb out of the gap into a flat spot, with a green meadow flowing out before us. In the distance, we spot Big Bald Mountain, our apex for the day. It seems impossibly high and unbelievably far away. But by now, I've learned that this perception is an illusion, so I put it out of my head. Though cloudy, the air seems clear, so we set off briskly, hoping for a glimpse of the spectacular views off Big Bald. I had hiked up there just last November with Bumpkin and Mudbutt and a few other friends from the Women Hikers internet list. Sunny it was then, and we were treated to some spectacular views of Mount Mitchell, that's the highest mountain east of the Mississippi, and Roan Mountain, our second highest climb on the AT. But alas, this trip, a cloud quickly catches on the crest of the Big Bald as we ascend her stony flanks. When we crest the Bald, we are walking in a thick fog. The mood in the low, shrubby rolling plain puts me in mind of the moors, and I half expect to see wild Exmoor ponies galloping out of the mist, mane and tail streaming. Heathcliff! On the crest, it was so cold and windy that we quickly exited. Pop-Pop told us that he had had sunny skies and trail magic here, burgers and hot dogs. A rutted mud track leads up to the top, and some ex-hiker had lugged up a grill. I believe that I will enjoy parceling out trail magic next year. On the other side, it got cold fast. The trail was turning greasy, and the wind followed us down off the crest as we wound through a strange forest of fantastically twisted trees. At a quick lunch at Big Bald Shelter, we learned that snow is predicted for the day after tomorrow. In the mountains at this time of year, pretty much any time it rains down below, we'll get snow above 3,500 feet. Most of the trail here is above 3,500 feet. As we descend the north flank, the weather spooks me a little. The frigid wind is tearing through the trees and the sky is throwing ice chunks at us. We hasten down the trail. Again, we get to our pickup point before 4 p.m. It's drizzling. We are wiser now, though. Our shuttle pickup isn't until 5:30, so we stick out our thumbs to hitch. Only one problem, though. A mere 3 cars pass through this isolated gap going our way. Finally, only 15 minutes before Miss Janet is due to arrive, a mercy truck stops for us. He took pity on us miserable, huddled, dripping wretches. The cold rain is pelting now, and we have been walking in sodden circles to keep warm and to keep our spirits up. Regretfully, we turn this trail angel down because surely now Miss Janet is on her way, and we don't want to put her out. We count down the minutes till 5:30. But at 5:35, soaked on an isolated country road, we had to do something. It was hypothermia city, so we started walking. About 35 minutes later, the gray van appears towards us. It was a silent, soaking, disgruntled group that climbed into that van. Miss Janet surveyed the situation and decided, rightly, that an all-you-could-eat pizza buffet for $3.99 would put a better slant on the evening. 8 hikers cleaned out the salad bar and kept the pie makers hopping. Ah, life was improving. Miss Janet's open house is like a college dorm, with all the chaos and camaraderie that comes with that scene. Tonight, it was all that and more so. The bad weather drove all the hikers down from the hills and packed the Irwin hotels and hostels. We lucky dry ones sat cheek to jowl in Miss Janet's living room with her two teenage girls, their dog Fabian, and 15 other smelly, grateful hikers. We watched the video, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? It was fun, and we stayed up way too late. Jan Leitschuh, AT Class of 03. See what I mean? Isn't her writing fantastic? Like I mentioned, she hasn't published these journal entries, and I just really appreciate her sharing them with us. But you know what she has done? Before she did her AT through hike, she did a through hike of the Vermont Long Trail, and she did write a book about that. It's called The Ordinary Adventurer, Hiking Vermont's Long Trail, a Primer for Baby Adventurers and Other Musings on the Nature of the Journey. You can find it on Amazon. I have put the link in the show notes, and I hope that you will go and order it because it is wonderful. I want to say a quick thank you to Steve, aka Mighty Blue. He's our fantastic producer. He is also the creator of the Hiking Radio Network. If you're enjoying the Trail Names podcast, definitely go check out the network. All the podcasts there are wonderful. And if you are enjoying our podcast, do me a favor, share it with your friends and family, share it on your social media. We want to get the word out about the Trail Names podcast so we can help inspire women to get out and hike, hike, hike. My name is Anna. All my friends call me Mudbutt, and I really appreciate you listening. Now go hit the trail.
I have always been a dreamer since I was a little girl. Someone's always trying to change me. Well, that can happen now. I'll do what I please. Yeah, life's gonna dance upon this earth. And I'm gonna find joy in all this madness. And I'm gonna be the one that you see. Living here now, feeling free. I remember from my childhood words my mother. Oh.